I thank you for your invitation to give me this unusual opportunity, unusual for me, to talk to your audience. And I will try to convey some ideas that I could have gathered during my life, or at least my professional life. So maybe let's see if this is working. Okay. So I will just tell you a few words about what happened in biology during the last century, which in fact consists in two revolutions. One of them is very well known, and I'm sure that you have learned about it at school already. This is the molecular biology revolution, which happened in the 60s, 70s. It started in the 50s. But there is a second revolution, which is less known because it is more recent, and which is called by different names, like post-genomics, like epigenetics, like biocomplexity. And this one started around the 90s, and we are still within it right now. Now, this one, I'm sure you know about it already. This happened, this is really the first biological revolution in the 60s. Where things which were absolutely unknown were uncovered, namely, first the physical substrate of the genes, then it was discovered that there are these special molecules known as DNA with the famous double helix, and the second, the uncovering of the mechanism of protein synthesis, which was an absolute enigma. Proteins are special molecules which are found in all living organisms, but no one knew how they are synthesized. Of course, it was known that they are made, that long chains made of a sequence of amino acids, of small molecules called amino acids, 20 of them, but in different orders. And this is the order which makes one protein molecule different from one another. But similarly, DNA molecules also are long chains made of a series of small molecules. Then it is only four of them, which are shown in the slide here. And again, they are in different orders. And this is a specific order that makes one DNA molecule different from another DNA molecule. And of course, the big discovery was that there is a correspondence between the DNA sequence and the protein sequence. And this correspondence is what is called the genetic code, and this is through this correspondence that proteins are synthesized by expressing, so to speak, this DNA sequence, that is what is written in the genes, if you wish. But I'm sure that you know about that already for a long time. Now, at that time, many biologists, and among them great ones who contributed to this fantastic discovery, thought that everything is known in biology. And among them, Jacques Monod said that really now everything is understood in biology, and the biological structures may be compared to crystals, but only more complex. And for him, apparently, more complex was a kind of explanation of the difference between the crystal and the biological structures. But at the same time, John von Neumann, the great physicist who was also the inventor of the computers, thought that, on the contrary, complexity does not explain, but it has to be explained, that complexity must be an object of scientific inquiry. And he predicted that the 20th century would be the century of complexity in the same way as the 19th century was a century of energy. Now, the idea that everything was understood based on the idea that on the structure of DNA and the mechanism of protein synthesis was based on a few assumptions which were accepted by almost all biologists, but which appeared to be false later on. These common assumptions, first of all, that there is a flow of information in one direction only, from one gene which codes for one protein, and the protein itself is responsible for one character, either structural or functional character. Second is that since it is known, and it was known already at that time, that the activity of the proteins depends on their three-dimensional structure, that is of the folding in the space of this chain, then it was assumed that this folding was in fact determined completely by the sequence, that is by the one direction structure of the protein. And finally, under the influence of the idea that these molecules, the DNA and proteins, were thought, and it was correct, to be information carrier molecules, and information in the technical sense of information theory, then the genetic code was confused with a genetic program. And this was used to explain, so to speak, everything, as if everything in a biological organism, that is the structure, the functions, the development, everything is determined by the structure of DNA only, as DNA would function like a computer program. Now, all this happened to be false under the influence of new discoveries, unpredicted and unexpected discoveries, for example, the possibility of cloning animals, the discovery of prions, that is a kind of infectious agent with no DNA nor RNA, and above all, under the findings of the General Human Genome Program. It was launched as a research program aimed at sequencing, that is, at discovery the order of all the ACTG of the DNA for the whole genome of several organisms, and among them of human. And the findings were not what was expected. What was expected was that one would have a kind of listing of a computer program, and it was not the case. And that's why a second revolution or a paradigm shift happened at that time, and this started around the 90s. Now, this shift implied a comeback of the proteins as carrier of biological information, not reducible to DNA structure. In other words, the three-dimensional structure of the proteins cannot be deduced from its linear structure, that is, from DNA. Second, from the idea that everything is genetic, then a shift was made to the study of complex interactions between genetic and epigenetic. Epigenetic means what is around the genetic. In other words, what controls the genetics to some extent. And this was forgotten completely during a few decades where everything was thought to be within DNA. And instead of that, and one has to study interactions between protein and DNA, where protein has an activity on the DNA, protein RNA interactions, protein between themselves, and so on. And all this is more adequately described by modeling, by building models of complex systems. Now, there are different sorts of models. And these models, some of them have some advantages, and some others have different advantages, and the same for disadvantages that some of them have and some others have as well. I want to show you one of the problems which we encounter when we try to make models of some kind of models of a complex system. And for this, I used an example which I found in my own work, where I was looking for how different cell populations, which make the immune system, how different cell populations interact with one another, so that in view of a so-called antigen, that is of a structure, molecular structure, or a parasite, the immune system responds to this foreign antigen by changing its own state. And the idea of the modeling was to consider each cell population as what is called a formal neuron. That is why this modeling technique is called neural network computing. Why neural? Not because they are neurons. They are not neurons. They can be, as a matter of fact, everything. Every unit which can be in several states. So for simple analysis, we can reduce now the idea of only two states. That is, each unit may be in rest state, like zero, or an activated state, like one. Now, all these units are connected in different manners with the others. They can receive a stimulating connection, which make them activated, that is going into the state one, or they can receive also inhibiting connection or suppressing connection, which suppress the activity. And every unit at every time compute its state by making the sum of the connections that it has received from the others. Among these connections, some are positive, the others are negative, and the algebraic sum is compared with a threshold for this unit. If the sum is larger than the threshold, then the unit goes to state one. If the sum is smaller than the threshold, the unit goes to state zero. And at every time, all the units of the network, here is represented a network of five units, so each of these units computes its new state. Either it remains or it changes its state, depending upon the states of the others and the connections that it receives. Now, and then what happens in general is that the network, after a few steps of computation like that, is stabilized. In other words, the units do not change their state anymore. They stay either in state zero for some of them, or in state one for the others, but they don't move, they don't change, and they are in a stable state. I mean, the whole network is in a stable state. Then the idea is to compare this computed stable state with what is observed in reality in the complex system that we want to study and understand. The idea is to understand what are, in reality, the connections between the units which constitute the system itself. Then it is not difficult to see that we face here a problem, which is the problem of underdetermination of the theories by the facts, or more precisely in this case, underdeterminations of the models by the observations. What does that mean? That means that for a given model, it's possible rather, for a given system to be modeled, it is possible to find several models which would be able to explain the system. And why? Just by a simple calculation which is showed here, if we can compute the number of possible states of the whole network. We have said that every unit can be in two possible states. Now, if you look at the five units, how many states for the five units? Then it is 2^5, that is 32. In other words, these networks can be only in 32 states, possibly. But now, what is the number of possible connection structures? Remember, each connection structure is a possible different model. Now, the computation is not difficult. The number of connection structures means in how many fashions is it possible to draw the arrows from one unit to the other. And then the computation is made at saying that for each arrow can be there or not. This means two possibilities for one single arrow. But there are, in that case, 25 arrows, since the five units can be connected to one another, which means that the number of possible drawing of the arrows is 2^25, which is around 10 million. This means, under the simplest assumptions, we have only 32 possible observations, that is, the states to be observed in reality and predicted by this model. But we have 10 million possibility to draw the model. So it is clear that among these 10 million, there will be tens, maybe hundreds, maybe thousands of different models which would predict exactly the same states among the 32 ones. There must be a convergence between the large number of possible models and the small, relatively small number of observations. This means that one should be very careful when we believe or don't believe in the value of a model which is considered to be true, to be good model. Good model in the sense that it predicts what is observed, but many others may be able to do the same. So this can be generalized, I mean, because we have assumed only two states for everyone and only five units, but this is generalized in any number of units and any number of possible states for every unit. And of course, we find always that the number of possible models or connection structure is always a square power of the number of units, n square here. Whereas the number of states is always a power n. This means that the more units, which means the more different variables in a complex system, the more the gap increases between the number of observed states and the number of possible models, because it increases like n. The number of that power n, rather, that the n being the number of units. Does that mean that there is always underdetermination, which would mean that there is no possible science? But no. Of course, in general, we try to avoid that by reducing n as much as possible. And if it is possible to have only one variable, then it would be much simpler. Or to increase as much as possible the observations, that is the number of possible states to be observed. But in general, for complex system in nature, it is very difficult, and we almost always are facing this underdetermination. The conclusion from that is that, again, one should be careful, and especially in disciplines where there is no possibility of experimenting. In biology, it's not dramatic, because we built a model. We think that it is good because it explains the few observations that we have. But then we are able to experiment after that and to try to check the possible new predictions that we can make based on this model and see if the predictions are verified. But what happens when we are dealing with a discipline where there is no possible experimentation? And I'm thinking about economy, of course, and also about ecology, and of course, the starting science of climate, where even if the specialists are using very sophisticated computer programs to build such models, they are facing such an underdetermination, which means that one should not believe blindly the conclusion drawn from such good models, because many of the models as good could be maybe the best one. Now, the kind of models I have been talking about are what is called bottom-up models. In other words, we start from observations in real life, measurements, and we try to put them together to build a model able to describe and, if possible, to predict the behavior of the whole system. And in that case, the more the system is complex, as I have just shown, the more the problem we are facing, the problem of underdetermination of the model by the observations. By the way, this underdetermination, of course, as you can understand, is not a very good thing for the poor guy who is trying to make a model of the reality, because even if he has a good model, then he must be careful about maybe not believing in it. But for the system itself now, if you don't look at the model, but if you look at the system, for example, the immune system, or the brain, which is made of real neurons in that case, or whatever, even a cell, where there is a network of chemical reaction and so on. For the real system, this property, which is a flaw or a problem for modeling, the same property is in fact a redundancy, a robustness for the system itself, because it shows that different structures may reach the same results. And in other words, if you modify or if for some reason the real system, the real network is modified, for example, the brain by accident, or the immune system, or even cells, then they may still continue to function because they, again, they do not depend on only one connection structure. Now, apart from these models which work bottom-up, there are what is called generic models. In generic models, one is not concerned so much about the reality. One is not so much concerned about how the real system is made. Generic models are constructions, abstract constructions, for which the aim is to show whether some behavior, some function is possible or not. And then, based on that, suggest possible structures which may exist or not exist, but at least are shown to be possible. Now, one of the first generic models for self-organization was proposed by Heinz von Förster, who was a famous cybernetician, and he suggested the following picture. These are cubes which are magnetized in such a way that three sides of a cube have a magnetic field in one direction, for example, from the inside to the outside. And the three other sides of the cubes are magnetized in the opposite direction, for example, from the outside to the inside. As a result, some of the cubes may be attracted to one another, and some others may be, on the contrary, repulsed by one another. Then these cubes are put like that, randomly, in a box. And then the box is closed, and the box is shaken randomly. And then from time to time, one opens the box, and this is what you see. In other words, you see the emergence of a structure from an initial state which was completely random. And what is the cause of this emergence of self-organization? It is, of course, the magnetization. But the magnetization itself is not enough. What is the cause of that also is the shaking of the box, and this shaking is made at random. So this was the first idea, that randomness, or in the terms of information theory, noise, can contribute to the emergence of structure. And this is what von Forster called an order from noise principle. Now, complexity from noise is something that I tried to formalize within the framework of information theory. Now, within the framework of information theory, one can represent the system as follows. So don't look too much at the formulas, and just look at the drawing. Now, this represents two sequences, if you wish. You can see, for example, the X, which is on the left side, as a DNA sequence, and the Y as a protein sequence, or both being two different DNA, two different proteins, and so on. And the idea is to look at what happens when there is transmission of information from input to output, from X to Y. Now, if the transmission of information occurs with no error, then, of course, the Y would reproduce the structure of the X. And there would be good, the information content of Y would be, in fact, equal to the information content of X. If there is noise now producing errors in the transmission, then, of course, these errors would decrease the information content which is transmitted in this channel. And Y would not have information content equal to that of X. And this can be computed, and the formula which expresses the effect of the noise, of course, shows it as being subtracted from the information transmitted in the channel. But now look at what happens if, instead of looking at the information transmitted in the channel, one looks at this channel as being only one part among others in a complex system, which is represented in the lower part of the drawing here. Then in that case, one is interested also in knowing what is the information content of the whole system. Then in that case, if there is no error between X and Y, then Y is merely a repetition of X, which means that the information content of the whole would be only the one of X. On the contrary, if there are errors between X and Y, then Y is slightly different from X, which means that Y brings with it an additional complexity or additional information content. So this is the basis of complexity from noise, showing how it is possible that under some conditions, that noise could produce not only disorganization, but also increase in complexity. Now, of course, there must be necessary conditions, not sufficient, but necessary conditions, which means first that we are dealing with a system with different levels of integrations. As we have seen, we must be able to distinguish between the level of the channel and the level of the whole system, the channel being part of it. And a second condition is that there must be, to start with, an initial redundancy. In other words, when Y is going to become different from X, then of course the system must be able to continue to function. So this is why this initial redundancy could be called a potential for self-organization. Now, if you look at the actual biology, we find that there are several biological applications of this principle of complexity from noise as a principle of self-organization. First of all, at the level of evolution, that we know, at least this is one of the results of the sequencing of the genomes, we know that there are many duplicated genes, and sometimes whole parts of the genome which are duplicated in the genome of some species. Then, of course, if mutations occur in duplicated genes or in duplicated parts of the genome, then these mutations are the equivalent of the errors I mentioned, and they allow for more complex genomes with decrease in redundancy. In the immune system also, there was for a long time a kind of mystery, which is the generation of diversity of the immune system. What is it about? The immune system is able to recognize a huge number of molecular structures and organisms, parasites, cells, foreign cells that it has never seen before. And how is it possible to do that? So then, this was a mystery which was called God, with the initials of generation of diversity. But now we understand, and we know, in fact, that the lymphocytes, that is the cells which constitute the immune system, the lymphocytes, during their maturation in the organism, have a small part of their genome which is mutating with a very high rate of mutations, completely different from the other cells of the organism, which means that under random mutations, the immune system produces a huge number of different cells able to synthesize completely different proteins. And of course, these are the completely different proteins which are able to produce or to be themselves antibodies or to help producing antibodies. In the development of the embryo, there is also such phenomenon which is called now developmental noise. An example for that is what is observed now in cloning of mammals, for example. As you know, this is done with more or less success, but this is done nevertheless. And for example, in calves, when they are cloned, one can see that on their skin, they have colored marks, but these marks are different, which means that the cloning, although it duplicates exactly the same genes, is not enough to determine the size and location of the marks. Same phenomenon is observed also in some parts of the nervous system during development, which start with multi-innervation, that is several nerves end up into, for example, a muscle, but during development, which means that they are redundant at the beginning, and during development, this redundancy is reduced and end up with only one innervation, which implies more specificity. In other words, one can say that this complexity from noise may be seen as a principle of deorganization, reorganization. The noise produces, to some extent, some sort of deorganization, but this deorganization may end up, not necessarily, but may end up into a new kind of organization. Now, I want to show you another example which makes use of neural networks, that is the same kind of networks that I showed you at the beginning, but this time they are big neural networks, and the goal is not to make a model bottom-up, but to make a generic model of self-organization and emergence in a large neural network. And in fact, this is what I want to show you as a challenge to make model of a very, very, very complex systems that you are going on this movie, which is taken from the famous movie 2001, Space Odyssey. Then you see great apes playing around with bones. And in fact, they end up in using these bones as tools or they're using the bones as tools or even weapons. Okay. Thank you. So the challenge is to make a model of this very, very, very complex system. You know, first of all, that not all the animals are able to do that. Not all animal species are able to invent tools or weapons. But some of them, like apes, are able to do that. Some of the species as well. Now, the idea is, how are we going to make a model of such things? So, of course, it would be impossible to make a model bottom-up, that is, to try to analyze all the details, what the apes are doing, and putting them together and reproducing this behavior. What we could do is a generic model of this behavior, showing how it is possible to make it mechanical. And for this first, we must make a first distinction between self-organization of structure and self-organization of function. That is, in the process of self-organization, in the one with the magnets that I showed you, it was clear that we are dealing with structural self-organization. What is emerging is structure, from homogeneous structure. But also, of course, if we want to look at the apes, we must be able also to produce a self-organization of behavior, of function, not only of structure. So first, we have to start with a structural self-organization. And in that case, this is what we can do with a neural network, in that case, a large one, which is made of 40 by 40 matrix. And each unit is represented by a different color, red or blue, depending upon it is in state 0 or in state 1. And then, I don't know if you see the pointer there or not. No. And then when we go from left to right in the second row, then one can see that one step after the other, that is one step of computation after the other, you see that groups of units are gathered within red groups, within blue groups, and slowly we end up with a non-homogeneous structure at the end, where subgroups are blue, some groups are red, and they are stabilized in their state. In other words, the last picture, the one before last, is the stabilized, self-organized structure. We have started from a homogeneous structure at random, and then because of the connections between the units, we end up with a non-homogeneous where a structure has emerged. For sometimes it is more convenient to make some averaging in order to make the structure more conspicuous and even geometrical, as it is shown here. Now, this shows what is dependent in the end product, that is the final state, on factors which produce them. And of course, there are two main factors. One is the connection structure, that is how the units are connected between themselves. And the other factor is the initial state, that is the input, the first state we are starting from, which in general is put at random. So here, the two rows, the one above and the one in the middle, differ by their input. In other words, they are the same networks, the same connections, but they have received different inputs at the different initial states. And you see, of course, that the final set are different. And on the two other rows, the one in the middle and the one below, it is the opposite, that is they have different connection structures. And in spite of identical inputs, of course, they end up with different final state. Now, based on this structural self-organization, one wants to produce an emergence of function. And in that case, the function that we want to simulate with the model is the emergence of a goal. That is exactly what we see in the picture of the apes. The apes has invented a new goal, that is to use the bone as a tool, the ape did not know it before, and we want to make a model showing how it is possible to do that without resorting to what is called mental states. So again, what happened in the picture? If you remember, the apes start by playing with bones with no intention whatsoever. They just play around. And by chance, one of them happens to hit something else or somebody else, some other ape, with one bone. Then he finds out that he can repeat the same gest, but this time with the intention of doing it. How is it possible? So this is the problem of teleology. Teleology is the action directed toward a goal. And in general, when we are looking for causes and effects, the cause precedes the effect. But in a teleological action, that is when it is directed toward a goal, then it seems to be like a time inversion, because the cause of the result happens after the action is done. In other words, you want to do something, then in fact, what you are doing is happening at the end because you are using a special procedure to reach this goal. But what happens at the end seems to be the cause of what you are doing. So therefore, there seems to be a kind of time inversion. And in general, in psychology, this kind of time inversion is solved by using the notion of a mental state. And this is how intentions are described. they are viewed as some kinds of conscious mental states which are able to cause bodily movements whenever an intentional action is executed. And then we assume that the mental state, of course, or the representation of the goal precedes the action, and then this action becomes a mechanical causal action again, because then the cause is not the goal when it is achieved, the cause is the mental intention. And there is a basic syllogism which is used by specialists, by psychologists in general, to describe such a behavior, that is a teleological or end-seeking action. And this syllogism is as follows. Somebody B has the desire to be in state S. B knows or believes that some C is a cause for S, and therefore B produces C. Now, there is a problem with this syllogism, is that it does not explain intentional action, it just describes it by assuming already intentionality, because the description includes the existence already of intentionality, at least at two levels. First, it explains the production of C, of the cause, as a mean to produce S, and it implies also the existence of intentional mental states, which are defined as desires or knowledge. And this is the primary flaw of the description. It must presuppose the existence of the intentional mental states. Now we want to build a model where this flaw would not exist. In other words, where would explain such a behavior by producing an internal origin of the goal. In other words, a self-organization of the producing or making the goal emerging from itself, and this would be a kind of model, of generic model, for what we called intentional self-organization. Now, to do that, we must, or we can, resort to a very interesting observation made by Elizabeth Anscombe, who is a philosopher, disciple of Wittgenstein, and who had written a very seminal book in 1957 called Intention. Now, she observed that the practical syllogism, which I mentioned before, somebody B has a desire to be in state S, B knows or believes that C is the cause of S, and therefore B produces S, that this practical syllogism is different from the usual demonstrative syllogism that everyone knows, the classical one that all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore Socrates is mortal. Now, this practical syllogism is different. Why? Because in fact it is redundant. It could be reduced to only two propositions, the first one being deleted because there is no real need for it. And in fact, this practical syllogism may be rewritten as follows. B knows or believes that C is a cause for S. Therefore, B produces C. The first part, that B has a desire to be in state S, is already included, implicit, in the therefore B produces C. Now, based on that, in this new form, we can rephrase the syllogism in words of a network. And we can say a network has learned or memorized a relation between a state S and some state C. And then when the network is in state S or close to it, then this state S may behave like a goal in the sense that the network starts from an input C again and is driven to S by its dynamics a second time, but this time it reproduces the same sequence but triggered by the network being, for the second time, in state S. This is what is represented here. You see, we start from an initial state, then like the ape is playing around, and by chance, it reaches the final state. The final state that it has hit somebody. But then this final state is memorized together with the initial state, and it is stored and kept in memory. Now, it may happen that another event, which is represented in blue here at the bottom of the slide, another event may lead to the same final state as it was before. But since this final state has been memorized together with the initial state, the whole procedure starts all over again. But this time, it looks like it has been triggered by the final state, which reproduces, in other words, the apparent time inversal. This is the same thing is represented here. You see from above to below, we start with an initial state of a network, which is represented on the schemes that I showed you before, above. Then we have this initial state is treated by the network, and it's stabilized in the final state, that is the output. But this time, this output is memorized together with the input. And if, again, the network may be put by different way into the same final state or something close to it, then the whole thing is repeated. Now, I don't want to get into more details now because it may be more technical. In fact, this is not enough. One has to add what is called a satisfaction function, that is just because it is not possible that every final state which would be produced by every input is going to be memorized and stored and behave as if it were a goal. There must be a kind of choice or preference, if you wish, between the end product, between the final states which are produced some largely at random. And of course, this satisfaction function must not be programmed by the designer of the model, because if that would be the case, then it would not be self-organizing. So what happens is that it is possible to produce the same thing just by looking at what happens at random. In other words, and looking at the final states which are produced more frequently than the others. And this relative frequency of the final states is the satisfaction function, which is not programmed because it is the result of the, on the one hand, of course, of the structure of the network, but also of the history of the encounters of the network with inputs from the environment, and this history, of course, may be largely random. Now, we can discuss rapidly the properties of these models. Then, as we wanted, we explained intentionalities through the study of intentional actions and not intentions. And this is what goes along with the ideas of Elizabeth Anscombe, where the action and the goal are one and the same thing. And the goal is not produced by an intention, by a mental intention. So this implies that intentions and actions are not dissociated to start with. This would mean that on a priori ground, every intention should be executed. But we know that that is not the case. So this means that, in fact, we have to explain why we have the experience that some intentions are executed and some are not. And this may occur when an intention is not executed because it is inhibited, because it is a result of an obstacle, a failure, or inhibition of the execution. And we're going to see that this is exactly what happens based on neurophysiology. Now, of course, one does not need to invent intentional mental states to explain such theological action. And but this, of course, is in contrast with our initial, usual insight of free will and of causal relation between will and action. We all of us, we experience that we have mental states, images, representations, conscious decisions, and that these are the causes for intentional or voluntary movement. But as you will see right now, that is not as obvious as it seems. When you look at some data in neurophysiology of voluntary movement, then you find that conscious will is not only always the cause of a voluntary intentional action. And these are very famous data obtained by Benjamin Libet, who is a neurophysiologist who studied by very precise timing of electrode activation in the brain of patients who were under surgery and who, of course, accepted to serve as the subjects of these experiments. Then he shows that when the patient decides to make a movement, decides consciously to make a movement, then the initiation of the movement in the brain, that is the first activity of a given area of the brain, where the movement is initiated, then the initiation of the movement occurs not after the decision, but before the decision. Then, very quickly, I will show you that, interestingly enough, the philosophy of Spinoza, based on some idea about the relationship between body and mind being two aspects of the same thing, and contrary, of course, with Descartes, then implies that there is no causal relationship between the mind and the body, and not because they would pertain to different substances, but precisely because they are one and the same thing, though expressed in two ways. So maybe I will skip several slides which show very interesting comparison between explicit propositions found in the ethics of Spinoza and what I have mentioned based on the models that I showed you and on the neurophysiology data. So I skip all that. And based on this view, we lose common sense about free will and causation of action by decisions and a non-body mind. In other words, we lose the common sense idea that this is my conscious decision to move, which is the cause of the movement. But we gain understanding of intentional actions without resorting to the hidden causal properties of mental states. And there are explicit statements by Spinoza saying exactly the same thing. Then this ends up with him with a kind of statement which is, in general, difficult to understand for usual moral philosophers, where the desire, and as it appears now in our practical syllogism, is nothing else than unconscious drive accompanied by consciousness, that is, by retrieved memory of the goal to which it is directed, but knowing that this consciousness is not the cause of the action. Now, this produces new ethical problems. So I don't know how much time I have yet. Comment? 10 minutes? 10 minutes. So now, already in 1959, there was a famous conference on the two cultures, which described the growing gap between natural sciences and humanities. Roughly speaking, on the one hand, you have science, which has become more and more materialistic and looking for mechanisms as determinist as possible. But on the other hand, you have humanities and still that are still dominated by a philosophical tradition, both idealist and vitalist, with important consequences in ethics, like in Kantian and post-Kantian philosophy. For centuries, life and thought were viewed as properties of some beings supposed to be different from mere material bodies, and the soul made the difference, as opposed to inanimate bodies. An anima, that is a soul, made animal bodies not only alive, but feeling, knowing, and thinking. Now, this non-material soul was endowed with sensitivity and intelligent behaviors, or at least instinctive, and it was supposed to culminate in the so-called human supra-sensitive domain of freedom, according to the words of Immanuel Kant, as opposed to inanimate material bodies. And this view is still considered by most philosophers and theologians as the only one possible, compatible with ethical thinking or moral philosophy. And I want to argue that this assumption is not correct. And in any case, the gap is such that what is called technoscience is often accused of dehumanization, while at the same time invading our day-to-day life and being a source of both fascination and fear. And in order to bridge the gap, there is a need for a new philosophy of nature, taking into account what we learn from biological and cognitive sciences, still in a critical, non-reductionist manner, but avoiding also idealist, essentialist definitions. And the need is all the more pressing that we are all the time confronted with ethical problems raised by innovations in science and technology, and especially by biology, what is called bioethics. Now, what is about when we talk about bioethics? So I will go quickly around that bioethics can be defined as a set of problems created by biology and medicine, problems that biology sciences alone cannot solve. That's why the term, the denomination bioethics is not really adequate, since it seems to imply that this is a sub-discipline of biology, like biophysics or biochemistry, whereas it is just the contrary. Now, these problems are difficult because we apply new scientific concepts like cells, genes, embryonic differentiation, biological evolution, to ancient ideas about life, reproduction, embryos, mankind, consciousness, in ambiguous ways. The old definitions are not relevant, and new definitions are evolving according to new discoveries and technological achievements. Moreover, biotechnologies have followed the path of physics and chemistry in creating laboratory artifacts. Until recently, only physics and chemistry were used to manufacture artifacts like machines or synthetic materials. And biology was merely a science of observation. But today, more and more biological artifacts are manufactured in laboratories. New problems are being raised because what we have learned from biology seems at odds with what we have been accustomed to think for centuries about life in general and human life in particular. Moreover, life itself is not anymore an object of scientific investigation. And then Georgi, who was a famous biochemist at the beginning of the centuries, said it in a very provocative way: life does not exist. I looked for it in my laboratory, but I did not find it. Now, later on, François Jacob said more or less the same thing, but in a less provocative way. One does not investigate life in the laboratories. The algorithm of the living is what we are concerned with. Of course, they do not deny differences between being alive and being dead. The only thing they want to say is that life is not anymore an object of scientific investigation. Of course, we experience it in our day-and-day life, so to speak, and it is still the object of literature and poetry, but it is not the object of scientific inquiry. Beforehand, life was used as an explanatory principle to explain what could not be explained by physics and chemistry. Today, life does not explain anything. It is what to be explained by physics and chemistry. So maybe I will skip all things that I wanted to tell you about the need for non-essentialist definitions, that is, the need for looking for giving up, looking for the essence. What is the essence of something? What is the essence of man? What is the essence of life? What is the essence of an embryo? What is it, and so on? Because, in fact, we are dealing with evolving processes, and therefore the definitions also evolve. What is not alive, for example, molecules, which make up a living cell, becomes alive. DNA is not alive. DNA is not the essence. It's not the essence of life. It's, of course, not the essence of man. The fact that we can use it for, like fingerprint, but for by DNA printing, so then does not mean that it is the essence of man. What we are looking for in this technique is the individuality of non-coding DNA. I did not mention that to you, but this is one of the reasons why there was the second biological revolution. There is a lot of non-coding DNA, that is DNA which does not code for any protein. And of course, this non-coding DNA is very, very highly variable from one individual to the other individual. And this is what is looked for by the police, for example, and by the court when using DNA for looking for individuality. But of course, this would be like to consider that this is the essence of the individual would be like considering the fingerprint like the essence of individual. And as a matter of fact, the fingerprint is even more precise than DNA because two identical twins have the same DNA, whereas they do not have the same fingerprint. And as a matter of fact, maybe as this, I don't want to skip because I think it's very important. Today, based on the kind of inertia in the history of teaching of biology, most people are not aware of the second biological revolution. And they are still stick to the first one, and they still consider that DNA is the essence of everything. And this is why now there is a fashion, which is ridiculous, to talk about DNA of everything, of a football team, of a political party, of a nation, of an enterprise, as if really it was the essence of this or that. And this is all the more ridiculous that now, for biologists who are working really in the laboratory, but that is not the case anymore. So maybe I will stop here and thank you for your attention. So I show you here, for people who are interested, a short bibliography of the different various fields where models of self-organization have been produced during the whole century, starting already in 1901 by hydrodynamics, then in chemical kinetics, information theory, thermodynamics, parallel calculus of artificial intelligence, Boolean networks, neural networks that I have mentioned, microscopic simulation, and so on and so on. And here is a recent bibliography where most of what I've tried to tell you can be found for people who are interested, both in French and English. Thank you.
We have just a few minutes for a quick question. Very inspirational one. I have just one question before. Where's the place of imagination?
Randomness. Well, what is imagination? Imagination is non-programmed production of images. And if it is non-programmed, where can it come from? From the, like the magnets.
Do you think that the next revolution in medicine will be the use of nanotechnology to cure the humans?
To cure what?
Human.
To use biotechnology?
Nanotechnology.
Ah, nanotechnology. Why not? I mean, this is a kind of, you see, in so-called in bioethics, there must be a principle, which is, I know, difficult for most people to keep, and it is to study the problems in a case-by-case procedure, not to say, I am for cloning, for human cloning, for example, or I am against human cloning, or I am for euthanasia, or I am against euthanasia. One should look into the details. Which kind of procedure you call euthanasia? And that they're very different procedures with very different ethical consequences. The same for human cloning. What is human cloning? If it is to reproduce a baby, then it is something. But if it is to produce only cells, which may be used in some treatments, for like stem cells, for example, then why not? And so it is called by the same name, but it's not exactly the same thing. It uses parts of the techniques which are the same, but not the whole thing. So therefore, you have to get into the details. The same for nanotechnologies. Nanotechnology is the whole thing. You must look at which nanotechnology case by case and look at what could be the consequences of using it.
Thank you.
Another question here. Sorry.
Yes, hello. So you said that the action preceded intention. So when we think intentionally. Does that mean that the idea comes before the intention of thinking, before the reasoning?
No, it's just the opposite. In other words, in the voluntary movement, what we think is happening, but in fact it is not correct. What we think is happening is that we first decide consciously to do something. In other words, the first thing is we think about something to be done, and this is supposed to be the cause of the action that we are going to do afterwards. And what is observed under some circumstances is that it is just the opposite, that the conscious decision does not come before the beginning of the action, but after. Not very long after, only 300 milliseconds, but nevertheless after, which means that something happens in the brain which is not conscious and which is the real cause of the movement. Contrary to our idea, to our spontaneous thinking. And the idea is that, in fact, we have been adapted to produce automatically a kind of antedating of the conscious decision. In other words, in reality, the conscious decision comes after. But since it comes, and not very long after, then we think that it has come before. But this is a kind of temporal illusion. You know that there are very well-known visual illusion in the brain. Sometimes if you draw parallels you know that they are parallels, but you don't see them as parallels. And there are a lot of visual illusions like that. This would be a kind of temporal illusion.
It appears your field about biology is now directly connected to other disciplines like physics or anthropology. How do you look or how do you project next researches? How will it be possible to cross these different disciplines?
Well, today already, as I have tried to explain, biology has become a physical chemistry, special physics and chemistry, but nevertheless physics and chemistry. And this is why there is a need to explain specific living properties based on non-living properties of non-living elements, of molecules and so on. But it is a fact, this is exactly what happens. We know now that an assembly of molecules, which are not living, under certain conditions may self-organize and produce properties of a cell, for example, which are living. And similarly, an assembly of neurons may be organized, may self-organize in such a way, because there is no one organizing from the outside. That's why all this is self-organization. So an assembly of neurons may self-organize and produce a brain which have properties of thinking, feeling, affects that no one of the neurons has. No one of the neurons is able to think or to understand or to feel something.
So we should stop for tonight. Thank you very much, Professor Yatla.